So, good afternoon. It's nice to be here. I'm going to be talking for about the next 45 minutes, a little bit about music and how you can communicate with music. And it's very nice to see so many people here whose hearts seem to be beating for it. My name's John Groves. This is my company, Groves Sound Branding. And we do exactly as the name says on the box. We brand things, but we use sound instead of vision, which is rather refreshing because people tend to mostly be visual these days. Sound branding has always existed, but it's a question of actually articulating what you are going to be doing with the sound. I'd like to start off by introducing myself. I usually introduce as a company, as you see on the screen there, and this is as an inspiration for composers trying to find their ways these days with a new job, to show that you can actually live from making music these days if you're prepared to compromise and maybe to subvention your art with doing something in the commercial sector. I did this many years ago and did music for advertising. Here are a few examples of work that I've done, not alone, with my colleagues and my company based in Hamburg, but we walk all over the place. I've also been asked to play a few examples of my work, which is not also usual for me. I'm usually talking just to clients showing systems, because it is something that's not just about the music that we use, it's about how we perceive it. So I'm going to be taking you right back to the beginning to see how music works in our minds and how sound, in fact, works. But before that, as I say, here's the advertising part as well, commercials, jingles for television, for shows, for events, and for radio stations as well. Important to know is that sound branding is not just about advertising, but I'll get to that. But to get you in the mood, here's a few examples of advertising.
The fresh maker.
Yeah, may not be everybody's cup of tea, but it's all about getting products, services, in fact, brands, into the minds of the recipients, of the consumers. This is the menu for today. As I said, I'd like to take you at the beginning right back to the basis of sound and how it works on us. Is it nature or is it nurture? Nature meaning, is it born within us? Or is it something that we learn over time and with the experience of life? So, now babies, when they're born, can differentiate between happy and sad music. In fact, already inside the mother's belly, babies can hear sound, the sound of the mother's heartbeat, the sound of the mother's voice. So from a very tender age, before zero, babies have an influence by sound. But as I say, when they're born, they will emotionally react one way to that and in another way to this. Now, they may not have a picture of a big shark coming to get them when they hear that, as we do, because we've seen the film. They haven't seen the film. But intrinsically, in the music, from its mathematical makeup, it's communicating to them one emotion. It says sad baby, he's scared shitless. He doesn't know why, he just knows because the music, it is a threat. Now, where does that come from? I'm gonna tell you. So, maybe not. So, we need it as a warning. The information that we get in sound in the forest is just as important as the information we get from the lack of sound, from silence. It also communicates something to us. In fact, when everything stops, we know that there's something wrong. If anyone's got a dog or at home, will know that occasionally they'll just suddenly go and stop. And you can see that their senses are honed. They're listening. They're being very attentive. They know that something's about to happen. And like the million-dollar man who can all of a sudden see very precise and hear very precise, if we're at home laying in bed and we hear a sound, we think somebody is downstairs. All of a sudden, we'll hear everything. We'll really zoom in on that. And in this case, we hear click. We say, oh no, there is something there. And we'll see something move. And we'll hear, ah, oh, Tiddles, that cat, I'll kill that cat. And we go back to life as normal, where everything is looking and sounding as it should be. And then it stops. Also, a warning, as I said, we'll hear that and we'll see something moving and we'll hear. Then something happens within us, fight or flight. In that case, I would seriously recommend that we take the second and we choose flight and we get out of there. But now, a lot has happened within us, and I'm not going to go into the mechanics of this, but I'm sure you all know that our brains work through chemicals, through hormones, and there certain hormones are secreted to make us more concentrated and to make us be able to choose flight over fight and to really get out of there. But the point I'm making is that sound has the capability of communicating an implicit message in less than 2 seconds, less than 1 second, less than half a second. We get a concrete message and it tells us something. And very often clients will ask me, oh, yeah, can I really say anything in 1 second? And yes, sure, you can say something in 1 second. In this case, what we've had, we've said that the sound of the lion roaring is 2 seconds, but what have we received for information? Well, we've learned at least there's something there. It's announced the apparition of something, something has changed. We have that purely by sound. We can identify what it is. We know it's not a bird, we know it's not a cow. We can actually differentiate it from other animals. We are going to be able to pinpoint it and to see what kind of threat it gives us through its size, through the volume of it. So I think you're getting the idea of this. We can also learn where it is, whether it's left, right, behind us, in front of us. Very important information for our survival. And on top of that, we know what kind of mood this big cat is in. And this is why, if he's angry, we really want to choose to get out of there. Now, this works also in visuals as well. I'm sure that if you look at these faces, you'll recognize happy, sad, and scary. But the question is this global? Does everybody have the same perception of facial expressions? In our case, we're asking, does everybody have the same perception, the same perception of sound? And this has constantly been a dilemma for musicians when we talk about the basses. We'll be talking about happy and sad and major and minor. But for the non-musicians of you, this has been something which has been sorted out here scientifically with the Marfa tribe. Now, the Marfa tribe lived way in the jungle, had no contact at all to Western civilization, and a very bright young scientist from Germany went there and gave them this simple test. He gave them stimulus, which he had already tested on his group back at the Max Planck Institute in Dresden, and so he knew what kind of results a Western audience would have to this music, to these sounds, Western sounds. I accent Western sounds because it is not global. There are indeed some differences. But in this case, he wanted to test if these Western sounds would have the same correlation to basic emotions. And in fact, they did. The correlation to happy, to sad, and to scary was exactly the same as in Dresden. So, what does this teach us? This teaches us inert inside of us are some basic understandings, at least to the goalposts of sound and of music and how it is going to affect us and how we are going to interpret the emotionality of it. Now nurture. Now this is another side of the same coin. This is the experience that we have in our lives. This is the music we listen to as children and that goes through our teenage life and shapes what we are and our preferences. And as I was alluding to, these are not global. These are most definitely local, and certain areas will have certain perceptions of what certain music means. And this is a kind of conditioning. Coming back to the Pavlovian dog. I wonder if I might ask for somebody who could bring me a glass of water before my voice absolutely stops. Thank you. Now that ding was the Pavlovian dog. Hands up, who knows what the Pavlovian dog is? Surprisingly few. This is a very interesting thing, especially for me, because Pavlov was researching actually gastric juices of the stomach. And to do this, he did something rather unique. He put a tube in the stomach of the dog to be able to register its responses to certain stimuli. And he had a bell to ring when it was time for food. And now what he noticed was nothing to do with his research. It was actually showing that the dog would respond to the bell because it associated the bell with the food that would be coming. Thank you very much. You're like a mother to me. Thank you. Ah. Okay, we'll see how long that stays there. So, this dog responded to what we now call Pavlovian, which means to an external stimulus that is learnt. It's learnable. So we know that if we ring the bell and have taught the dog that this means that food is imminent, that he will start dribbling. And so somewhere in his brain, we've made the link. And this is one of the bases that we, in sound communications, use as a premise for contacting. I hope you're with me so far, because I'm going to move on now to something even more musical, and this is the mathematics of emotion. How do we actually do it? Now, this is the nuts and bolts. This has got nothing to do with the politics we've been talking about. This has got nothing to do with the techniques. This has to do with the way that sound works on us. And if we want to use sound to identify, to differentiate, to basically communicate, we should understand a little bit about how it works. And this is sadly lacking in our musical educational system that seems to have passed over this matter. What we need to understand how we're going to communicate is this list you see behind you of musicology, of sociology, history, neurology, and so on. We need to have some knowledge of how music affects us in all these different areas. I'm not going to go through all of that, because that's not that kind of lecture today. But I want to give you just a few. The effects of music on emotions and thoughts, on our psychology, or physiology, excuse me, and on our behavior. Now, as I said before, the goalposts left and right are major and minor. How many of you here today play a musical instrument? Hands up, please. Good, that's rather a lot. I'm very happy about that. So you'll understand the basic between this, a major chord, and this, a minor chord. Now the premise is that one is happier than the other, and it will be the major chord. The premise is not that all music that's ever been written in a major chord is happy, or that all music in a minor chord is sad. But if we played Happy Birthday in a minor key, it would most definitely be perceived as being sad to most of you. And I say most of you because it's not all of you. There is always about 5% of people that don't quite get it when it comes to the emotionality of music. But it's very important to realize that there are actual ways of addressing the 95% to be able to get a similar response. Now, if we listen to this piece of music, this is Also sprach Zarathustra. You may know it as the theme music for 2001. Same. Is also a feeling the sun goes up. These are the feelings that I hope 95% of you are feeling. If you're one of the 5%, don't worry, it's not bad. Now, of course, I'm oversimplifying it. We don't have all day to go with it. This is something which we could go into much further depth. There's a lot of other parameters. There is the orchestration, the instrumentation, there is the tempo, the genre. But just to give you an idea here, this is a similar tempo, a similar orchestration, the same kind of film music. One, I think most of you will find one way, and the second one, I hope you'll find the other way. I'll tell you how I find it. Ah, everything is good. This is in the minor key. It's dripping with emotion. It's sad, it's melancholic, but it's basically the same tempo, the same kind of instrumentation. But that's giving you just a basis to say that we don't start from scratch. We have some basic tools that we can deal with. Now, music that we're going to be using in communication, we have to understand how it is going to affect our emotions and thoughts. For instance, musicians among you will know what that is. You know, if you come to a piano and you hit C and C sharp, a small second, you're going to have a mathematical dissonance. In fact, it will even start beating because the frequencies are so close to each other, and it can give a rather unpleasant feeling. Put this in a higher octave with strings, and it will actually physically give you a feeling. So it has a measurable value. Now, combining that with... And I must admit, I'm very disappointed because there's usually at least one person in the audience that starts doing this. And today you're either shy or tired, but nobody did it. Or you haven't seen the film. I don't know which one it could be. But, oh God, I've seen nodding heads, so you're all regretting not being the one and keeping me happy, eh? Because then I can say, ah, look, music has the power to actually move your hand. So not just to condition your thoughts and give you memories, but to also see something in your head, to see pictures of somebody in the shower. By the way, you never actually see the knife going in that scene. You just see blood and shower curtains coming down. But what stays in your head is that sound and this action. And this is all done by music. Can you imagine that is your job? You're at a dinner party and say, well, what do you do? What kind of music do you make? Well, I do lullabies. Yeah, but there are people, Brahms, that made a pretty good living at writing just that kind of stuff. Now, here's something in German, and it's a work of mine. This is motivation. And for those of you that don't understand the lyrics, I'm sure that you'll get the feeling. Wenn man gewinnen will, dann kommt man. The thing is, it doesn't matter what you think about it yourself, whether you like it or whether you're having a nosebleed right now when you hear something in that genre, it actually works for the majority. And when we want to motivate people, music is wonderful. It's a wonderful tool for doing that. This music, I wrote this for Texaco just before they sold their German operation. They had to, unfortunately, because of the Valdez Exxon problem. But being at the right time at the right place, which is also very important for a career, happened to be there when it was going to be rebranded. More about that later. Now, music can say an incredible amount about things. We're going to be talking about destination branding in a minute, but a lot of destinations already have their own kind of signature sound as well. What country is this? Anybody? You've got it. And this? How about that? Less than 1 second and we've said Greece. Now, that's rather amazing. I have a lovely story for that, but we don't have time. I'll tell you another time. Now, this used to be when we were young. Unfortunately, my team have changed it usually to when I was young. But this is something which, for me, when I hear this at my age, has a particular importance. And it's very easy to calculate this performance. It's usually back down to the years in puberty when you have the first love. And the music that's around then is potent. It's really powerful and it stays with you forever. But throughout life as well, there's always other opportunities. But when I hear this, I was 14. I remember the games cupboard. It was lovely. But that's also another subject. Now, physiology. Music can measurably actually change our physiology. And for those of you that are responsible for branding anything, whether it be a chocolate bar or a city or something, that sound is going to be an important part of it. How does the brand sound? Because the sound can not only trigger these responses, it can also physiologically do things. Like, for instance, here, if you can read the fine print there, you'll see that this sound can actually measurably get your heart bumping faster and can make your blood pressure go up. It can also irritate you, so I'll move on to the next one. Physiologically, you can relax to music, to sound. My company is doing a new relaxation app at the moment, and it's really lovely to produce it because the atmosphere in the studios is lovely and relaxed. So here you will actually see that the pupils will close, the heartbeat will reduce, the blood pressure will reduce, the measurement of the electricity on the skin will go down. When you listen to music like this, whether you want it or not, it works automatically. The gentleman at the front is falling asleep. I better stop it. Now, my wife, Patricia, who's with me today, is from Brazil, and they have it in their blood to dance, no matter where. I don't know whether you've seen the film Happy Feet, but it's so wonderful being in the supermarket where music actually starts there. Then I say to Patricia, what are you doing? The music's on as she's dancing. I say, no, don't know what's happening. It actually goes into some people so their feet will actually start tapping for music. So our behavior can be unconsciously actually steered by what we hear, even if we're not listening. And armies can actually march much further and much more effortlessly with music. It keeps them basically in beat. Any idea what kind of rhythm an army would march to? What key signature? Okay, as we're not musicians, we won't have that. Of course, it's 2-4. It wouldn't work quite as well with the waltz because they don't have three legs. I can imagine they'd be rather confused. But a nice 2-4, boof, 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 boof. They can march for hours and hours. Like this, it's possible to influence the purchase behavior of people in supermarkets to get them to buy German wine instead of French wine and vice versa. Now, somebody who lives in Germany but loves French wine, I really didn't believe that, but until I met the people that did the research work, and it is incredible because it works every time. We are really steerable by that, what happens in our brains without us knowing. It's rather scary, the word manipulation I don't want to say, but it is actually possible to influence people in that way. Now, one important thing as well is the perception of quality. I'm sure you ladies with hair dryers will know the difference between a cheap hair dryer that you've bought at the dime store on the corner and one real Rolls-Royce hair dryer. They will sound different, they'll feel different, they won't vibrate as much, and you will have a perception of the value of it, even if the actual performance isn't any better, but the smoothness, the vibration, and the sound will have a relevance. In this case, we're talking about wine. Again, I seem to be a bit obsessed with wine in this place. But here is a little game for you to play. How much do you think this wine should cost? Rather cheap, I would say. 5 cents, 10 cents, 1 euro, I don't know. Now, I'm not here to sell you anything. I'm just here to tell you that this actually works. It really does. There's a whole lot of information about this and studies where spaces have been played with different music, and the perception of the value of the ambience or of certain products and the preparedness to pay a price for it, to put a value on it, changes with that what we hear. So if this is possible, then we should maybe harness the power of music to steer the perception of our users, of our customers, or of our visitors, should we be a city. This we do already. We do this with logos, with colors, even with names, with slogans. We do this with architecture. But this is the visual identity. We want to create the desired perception in the brains of the people that are looking at us, and the objective of sound branding, the target situation, is to do this, what you see on the screen. We want to be able to steer the perception in all touch points. Now, if we're talking about sonic pollution, which I'm sure there's some of you sitting there thinking, oh God, this guy is going to really help make the world sound horrible with ding-dong, bing-bongs everywhere. Well, in fact, there always have been, and probably always will be, sounds that we need to navigate through life. And these sounds are there when the lift comes, when the flight is late, when the train is coming. But it's a question of not just making these pleasant, but of harmonizing them. The pollution comes through the cacophony of different sounds. And when we want to communicate, we're talking of consistency, of using sounds that fit and using them in all of these touch points at the bottom there. Now, for a brand, they have an awful lot more touch points than you can possibly imagine, unless you're a marketing person, which I don't think many of you are here today. But we tend to think of sound branding as advertising. We think of Intel, we maybe think of McDonald's, which, by the way, were both German productions. We seem to have created a mecca for sound branding in our country. But when we look in all these different touch points, we find that there's lots of places that use sound. And that if we unite these signals, we have a responsibility not to pollute, then we're going to be able to create the desired impression with sound. That is basically what it is. And if that has come home, then I really could go home, because I don't need to tell you anymore. But as I still have a little bit of time, I will. So that wasn't meant to be a little advertising spot, although I realize it was. But this is also just to show that from sound that companies and brands should really demand the same level of expertise that they do from all other areas. You'll find that the smallest differentiation in a Pantone color or the form of a logo will really shock a marketing director, but the sound he will gladly give to his neighbor's next door neighbor's son because he owns a computer. Nothing against bedroom producers, as we've just seen there, that it's very good that the production tools have been democratized, but the expertise doesn't come automatically. There's been an incredible explosion in the ratio between supply and demand, and by giving everybody a Steinway piano, we're not going to have millions and millions of budding Horowitzes. We'll end up just with some rather good sounding versions of chopsticks. So it's important to really demand the same level of quality and attention to detail. The good news is sound branding is now being taught in universities across Europe. So it's not quite as much as a hit and miss thing as before. Now, I'd like to give you a definition of sound branding. This is the boring one. Sound branding is the strategic process for developing, implementing, and managing the music and sound a brand uses in its communications with the specific intention of differentiating and identifying the brand by reflecting its values, attributes, and personality via constant and consistent controlled use in all applications and touch points. And I noticed there wasn't one full stop in there, all one sentence. But in science, we like to be very exact, even if it can be very boring. Now, in marketing, we like to be the opposite. We like to be very, very compact. And so here is our claim, which is your sound everywhere, always, which says about the same. Now I'm going to show you, not in great detail, but just basically what that means. Now people tend to want to differentiate and to have variety, but in marketing, it's not such a good idea to have a new look every time. We want recognizability and we want consistency of youth. What we want, our target situation, is to have a holistic design, a sound identity, that is used consistently in all touch points and thereby creating the desired image of the brand in our minds. Now I'm going to give you an example of this with city branding, destination branding. It could just as easily be dog food, it could just as easily be chocolate, and even if it's a city, it should not be any less worthy because it has the same problems and will enjoy the same benefits from sound branding. Now, what is city branding spaces? It's controlling the perception in the observer's mind, exactly the same as what I've been talking about earlier. It's the development of a core personality, which is perceived as matching both for the people living there and for the tourists, the people that are coming there. And it should be something unique. It should differentiate it from other cities. And as I've said, and will always keep on saying, it must be consistent. There must be constant communication. Now, architectural icons, that is a no-brainer. It works incredibly well. Unique buildings in places you can identify, I'm sure, each of those cities just by their architectural icons. So most cities have understood that, and the bigger ones are, in fact, doing it already. Now, slogans is a very useful tool. Las Vegas has "What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas." The Big Apple in New York, "The city that never sleeps." The Big Easy in New Orleans, and so on. I mean, Detroit with Motown actually had Tamla Motown as a music. So that was the beginning of knitting these things together, but it was far from being holistic. They actually have songs that can remind you of these places. New York, New York, or in Australia, you just have to hear Waltzing Matilda, you'll think of Australia. Paris, lots of songs about Paris, and San Francisco is the same thing. So when you're building up an identity, there are several ways to do it. A cultural identity here, for instance, Vienna, the Blue Danube. Now, Vienna is a place that recently has a sound identity. They have a sound logo, they have music, which you'll find actually in all of their trams, in their telephones. Now, Glasgow, I put this one here because Glasgow don't have a sound identity. And I remember talking to the Lady Provost at her new pamphlet, where she wanted to be cosmopolitan and had pictures of ethnic minority groups on the brochures to show how open they were to the world. And my suggestion that they should perhaps use the existing icons that they have, such as the kilt, the sporran, the thistle. There's a lot more that we can think of when we think of Scotland. She said, those are cliches, as though that was absolute rubbish and we do not want to use cliches. Now, creative people are always very shy of cliches, but cliche, the word itself, will mean that people know it, where there's an existent relationship already built up to an object or a sign. And these are the things that we can start to build on. Remember our touch points. We have to be able to communicate equally in all of these places. A city has many of these touch points. And as I say, you may not think of them instantly, but when you start to think, where do we make noise and where can we organize this into pleasant sound, into sound that has some kind of meaning, we can think here straight away of our ports, of our airports, of our hospitals, of our financial institutions, the telephone lines they have there, the open spaces. And again, if any of you are saying, oh God, you know, that's gonna be really horrible, think about it where there is sound being used at the moment, and it's all different at the moment. It's saying nothing at all about the values and it's gaining no recognition. Here's an example. Now, like it or not, it is iconic, but it is not Paris. It's Charles de Gaulle Airport, and now if you go to Gare du Nord, you'll hear that sound logo. We heard about Brian Eno earlier on, and actually he's written something very positive about this sound logo recently, and found it very inspiring. They use it consistently in all trains. But once again, these are separate unities, and this is not sound branding for a city, it's sound branding for the airport or for the train line. But the idea of city branding would be to have a holistic sound in all of these touch points. Now, this is very difficult. It's easy to say. I know that for brands that we have, such as Olympus, for example, who we've finished their cameras 2 years ago, to get this small sound, doo-doo-doo, into cameras globally took over a year. Cost a fortune. Was totally unnecessary had there been another structure. But knowing the structure and having to work within it, it was very difficult to convince all stakeholders that it would be beneficial to them for the cameras to sound similarly globally. And this means that we need to have a system. I see I still have a little time left, so I'm going to show you this. Although we've gone deaf, I didn't hear anything. I hope you haven't pulled down the fader, Mr. Technician. We'll check it again because there's sound coming later that's going to be important. Okay, well, I've probably just gone deaf. We'll see if it comes later. Now, what that says, the sound effect there was throwing the dice. A lot of the time is like that. The people responsible for the trade fair, for the internet, for the TV, for the telephone, they will be autonomous. They will have their areas and they'll have their own ideas of how to communicate. And the job at hand then must surely be to engage a system and to get everybody singing from the same page of the choir book. They must all really be pulling on the same strings. And what they need then is to have a process for the development, for the implementation, and then also for the management of this brand sound. And here we have our structure system. Now, I'm not going to go through this in great detail, so don't worry. Otherwise, I'd imagine you all running for the door. But what I'm going to do is just show you very shortly your sound everywhere, always, what that means. It means your sound is a sound that's going to reflect brand attributes, the attributes of the product, of the city, of the airport, whatever it is. We'll find out there will be certain attributes that will be part of the identity. And there may be an image already there. We will check the image identity correlation to see that it is in balance. What your sound means also is not somebody else's sound. It means a sound that is going to be uniquely yours. So what one must do is a competitive review to look in the relative mark sector and to see, does anybody else sound the same? That is your sound. Now, everywhere means all over the place. In all of the touch points that one has, there should be a corresponding, a similar sound signal that's going to gain the recognition of the recipient there. Here we see above the line and below the line in marketing. Now, in recent times, the line has disappeared. There are more things that are being communicated below the line, and we're talking about telephones, websites, for apps, and so on. And it's important there to also to have consistency in all appliances, also in all countries. Now, always means exactly as it says, all the time. One must have a brand sound manual that contains the rules of usage, and then one must monitor. That was tool number 10, the monitoring tool, to make sure that the lovely garden that you've made doesn't have a lot of weeds in it within a few weeks, because when things are not tended to, that does indeed happen. Now, I will rush through this because this is not interesting for you, but it's to show that in existing marketing techniques that it does actually have its place. Right beside visual, linguistic, and behavioral, there is indeed a slot there for the visual identity. And whereas linguistics will actually have corporate language, the way that you address your interest groups, you will also find that sound has exactly the same possibility there. You'll develop a sound identity which will have all of the elements that one needs to use, which will be prescribed in a usage manual and will ensure that you sound the same everywhere. Now, I'd like to finish now just with a short show of this in the practice, how it actually works. Now, this is going to be a sound logo. Very, very short. Now, it has to be short because it's going to be used in lots of places where you don't have much time. Time is money and time is attention, and both of them are often rather scarce. So it has to be short. Now, here's an idea of a song.
We're reaching up and beyond. Let's make people smile.
Now, here subliminally, it's built in there. It's because when something is used very often, you don't want it in the face, you don't want it to wear out too quick. So it's built in there in the background.
We're reaching up and beyond. Let's make people smile.
So these are for the different uses. That was more premium. Here's for the younger, hipper people. So there's the combination of Let's Make People Smile, which is the slogan, and the music. They will then use this. And moving on here, soundscape. Do have a rather good function of masking the silence, because there's nothing worse than silence.
Zum Beispiel in einem Sensima Resort und Spa. Jetzt in Ihrem Reisebüro und auf TUI.com. TUI. Zeit für neue Ziele.
And there, as a tagline, as like an acoustic rubber stamp at the end of all films, very disciplinedly, which you will recognize it. In fact, you'll recognize it even if you're not watching the television. Even if you are in the kitchen or you've got your head inside the refrigerator getting a beer, you'll still subliminally have a contact. So that makes it very valuable.
Hello, TUI all over the world. I'm honored to be part of the TUI mission with a new song, Let's Make People Smile. I hope you love it. I hope you like it. And I'm excited to see you soon. Let's have some fun. Cheers.
Let's make people smile. Let's make people smile.
So we call these band-brand cooperations, getting an evangelist, a band or an artist to actually go out and represent the band. So there we've had it, and so on, in all of these touch.
Good brands have their own personality. Good brands know how to project an image. Good brands differentiate and communicate consistently in all touch points and all the time. Good brands reach the minds and the hearts of the people they come into contact with. Olympus is a good brand. Better brands can get a better share of mind by using all available tools and senses. Now the ear is located approximately the same distance away from the brain as the eye. Sound communicates emotions and triggers memories and associations. Good brands become better brands when they turn this into this. Welcome to Olympus Europe. Please be patient. You will be connected to the next available operator as soon as possible. By sending the same message using both sight and sound, your brand communications will be more effective, more efficient, and become more easily recognizable, clearer and better. Make a good brand into a better one with sound branding. Olympus, your vision, our future.
So I'm now at the end. I hope you've had a brief look then into the intentional use of sound. This is applied music, and it shows also the importance of sound in responsibly looking after the soundtrack of our lives. And when it's going to be designed, it sounds cheesy to say making a better sounding world, but at least the risk of pollution is a lot less if you have something like this going on. Thank you very much.